Dorchester Hotel, London, where one of the biggest birthday parties of the year is being held for the 85th birthday of Lord Beaverbrook, the host of the evening, Lord Thomson of Fleet. And since this is a party in honour of one of the greatest Canadians of the 20th century, four Indian chiefs are in attendance. They were specially brought from Canada for the occasion. And when Lord Beaverbrook arrives, they will form one half of the Guard of Honour. The other half will, naturally, be Mounties, four troopers of the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. Lord Thomson welcomes the guests as they arrive. There are 650 of them, all men, and most of them connected with Fleet Street or with Canadian journalism. Lord Rothermere is a friend and a rival of Lord Beaverbrook's. It is a measure of the Beaver's personality that so many people are both. Mr. Ian McLeod is also one of the top table guests. Another MP, Mr. W.F. Deeds. No one can mistake the significance of the symbol in the foyer, least of all the guest of honour. Lord Beaverbrook arrives at the Dorchester with his wife, but for the time being she leaves him. This is strictly a stag party. The fanfare is played by trumpeters of the Royal Air Force Cranwell to recall Lord Beaverbrook's wartime work as Minister of Aircraft Production. Host and guest of honour take their places at the top table, as remarkable a company of 32 men as one would be likely to see at one board in a very long time. On the right wing for once, Lord Morrison of Lambeth. The Baron of Beef is brought in by the head chef himself, with the help of the Mounties. Mr. Paul Getty watches as the first slice is cut. Dr. Beeching is also an expert on cuts. In the best tradition, host and chef drink a toast in champagne. There's some for the Mounties too, of course. No criticism from the doctor, Lord Hill of Luton, as the beef is served. The variety of guests at the top table, indeed of the whole company of guests, reflects the astonishing variety of activities with which the Beaver has filled his life. The cake is in seven tiers because seven is Lady Beaverbrook's lucky number. And each of the tiers recalls a milestone in Lord Beaverbrook's career, from his birth in 1879 to this great party tonight. Lord Beaverbrook cuts the cake with one of the Mounties' swords.
Ladies and gentlemen, pray silence for the Lord Thomson of Fleet, your chairman.
My distinguished guest of honor, my lords, my distinguished guests, gentlemen. I have several messages. We've received a great many messages, but there are two in particular that I think I should read to you. Here's a message recorded by the Duke of Windsor in New York at 11:15 a.m. today, New York time. That's, as I make it, 4:15 our time here. It is being transmitted in the BBC Panorama program tonight, and I quote the message. From New York, I am glad to be able to join Lord Beaverbrook's countless friends and admirers and well-wishers on this, his 85th birthday. Lord Beaverbrook, a long-standing, tried and trusted friend of the Duchess of Windsor and mine. He has had a full and successful life in the fields of finance, politics, journalism, and the philanthropic field. Max started life with no particular advantages and many handicaps. As a boy, there was no reason to anticipate anything other than a future usual to his circumstances and environment. Who could have known of the determination, the great determination to succeed? The iron will, the great ability, the restless energy, the superb courage, the complete dedication. All those great qualities that have carried him from success to success. Our views do not always coincide, as is inevitable with men of independent mind. But he has always tolerated my brashness, always condoned my mistakes, always forgiven my trespasses. My respect, my admiration, and my affection for him has never wavered. To me, he is the great profession. That I am privileged to give him this dinner as a birthday tribute is the accomplishment of a lifetime ambition. Lord Beaverbrook is a legend in Canada. Everywhere he is greeted as the greatest living Canadian. I know I speak for every Canadian when I say, and I've said this repeatedly, I am proud that Max is a Canadian. At this period in his life, he enjoys the companionship, the love, and the care of his wife, Christopher, also so well known in Canada for her great benefactions. Long may this... Long may this partnership continue. Long may they live and enjoy good health and happiness. May you have many happy returns of your birthday, Max. I am delighted that Lord Rothermere is supporting this toast. There could be no one more appropriate. And incidentally, I might mention that he will celebrate his 66th birthday this Friday. Congratulations, yeah. Everyone. And now, Esmond, we'll welcome a word from you.
Lord Beaverbrook is, without any question, and would have been, without any question, a most remarkable man in any kind of work that he had taken up. Whether it had been, whether he had continued in politics, whether he had continued in industry, or whether he had gone into newspapers, he was bound to be a success. The only thing that is strange is that he should still be with us at the age of 85.
Finally, that rare event, a speech by Lord Beaverbrook himself.
I will try to make you a speech tonight, but in my 86th year, don't expect much. It's past time for speaking. You'll forgive me if I refer to my Canadian hero of long ago, who's influenced my whole life. I speak of Sir John Macdonald, born in Scotland, Canada's greatest orator, and Canada's greatest prime minister. He was my ideal indeed. I hoped to follow his teaching, and I often wished that I could speak like him, but I never managed it. He fired me with enthusiasm for the British Empire, and I have been an imperialist ever since. But not too successful, as you know. Well, I did go to London. But then I decided to become an apprentice in politics. After settling this grave issue, of making a political career, I disposed of my Canadian business to my principal lieutenant. Killam was his name. I took out my meager share. And after 50 years, Killam died worth 150 millions. Perhaps I might have done more harm if I'd stayed in Canada with all that money. However, I was by this time an apprentice to politics. And I sat 6 or 7 years in the House of Commons saying very little, but possibly learning a great deal. War, I served Lloyd George. It was a nerve-wracking duty. It was hard to keep in step with that great prime minister. But I managed. After war, I became an apprentice in Fleet Street. And that was a real exciting experience. At last, I thought, I will be a master, fancy free. Instead, I became the slave of the black art. I did not know freedom again for many a year. Even on the contemporary scene, I have been a minor figure, while Montrose's name will live forever. I'm only comparing our fates. Both of us came to failure after initial success, and both of us were let down. Montrose was let down, strange to say, by the Earl of Hume. And I was let down by the present Earl of Hume's predecessor. You know what I mean. I'm happy to say that the comparison stops there. And like Montrose, I was not let down at the end of a rope. The Second World War. And once more an apprentice. This time to industrial production under Churchill's guidance, and he sustained me. Without his support, I would have failed completely in my task. Didn't stand a chance without his backing. We were so ill prepared. Our peril was beyond comprehension. Churchill, after taking off, said to me, "We will come through in triumph, but we may lose our tail feathers." In that belief in victory, he remained steadfast through 3 years of incredible misfortunes. Never wavered, always steadily looking forward to the day of victory. What was the genius of this great leader? Many have tried to analyze it. It was incompatible greatness in two spheres. There are men with a magnificent command of words, but with a very poor command of events.
Lord Beaverbrook ends by scotching any rumors that he might now relax.
This is my final word. It is time for me to become an apprentice once more. I'm not settled in which direction, but somewhere, sometime soon.
Great Canadian, a great Briton, in the rather old-fashioned sense of which he is unashamedly proud. For Lord Beaverbrook is a man who follows no fashions, he creates them. His achievement, the affection, often exasperated, the admiration, often reluctant, of friend and opponent alike. The affection and admiration due to a fighter.